Great, full room. I think the last people are inside now. So welcome everybody, great to see you all here. Crowded room, that's a good sign, I suppose. Also a warm welcome to all the people on the stream who are following the event online. I hope you guys can hear and see me well. So first, thank you to our sponsors, KLM, the Royal Dutch Airline, and Big Data Republic, a data science consultancy firm. Thank you for hosting the event in this beautiful location, and a first note to all of you guys, if the event makes you interested, both parties are always looking for people passionate about data science and or data engineering, so feel free to reach out during or after the event. Let's see if this thing is working already. So then back to the event. The topic for tonight will be forecasting of airline passengers. And this fits in really well to the theme of our meetup. So the hands-on data science meetup, right? So the aim of our meetup is to share with you guys the experience we gained from doing real hands-on data science projects. So stepping beyond the stuff you can all learn in online courses, for example, but really share with you the learnings we gained from doing hands-on data science work, putting models into production. So today we have a slightly different concept than we had before. Today we'll go with you guys through a full cycle data science project. So going all the way from initial business ID all the way to putting the model into production. So if I go to the agenda then, fancy animation. So first, Maarten Ooster from KLM will introduce you guys to the your name is not on the list, huh? To the beautiful world of airline operations, and he will explain you how data science is taking an increasingly large role in improving the operation. Then Joyce Morren will introduce the project, so the business side of the project, to you guys. Then Alexander Bakkes will take the floor and he'll explain the data science aspect of the project. Dan Deby, also KLM, will then explain you guys how everything is tied together by the data engineering part of the project and how the model was industrialized. And after all this, there will be time left for drinks, gezelligheid, and some networking possibly. We agreed with the World Trade Center that we'll start asking you guys to leave at around 9. It's not super strict, but about 9. So without further ado, I'd like to give the word to Maarten Ooster.
Just put it in my pocket?
Whatever works. There you go.
Which button is the next one?
One more.
Yeah, here we go. All right, welcome everyone. I want to welcome you all on behalf of KLM Royal Dutch Airlines and of course Big Data Republic. I also specifically want to thank Tom and Paula who are the masterminds behind this whole evening. So thank you for organizing this. It's an honor to have you all here and especially of course to have you here at Schiphol Airport where I think under other circumstances you have a very nice view of our operations actually taking place. I want to tell you a bit about KLM, a little bit about how we work and why we got involved with data science in the first place before I'll give the word to Joyce Morren of our in-flight department to tell more about the project we're discussing today. Yeah, it's not about AI. This is something I sometimes like to start with because for us it's not. We are in a process of taking KLM to the next step with data, with optimization, with a new technology that allows us to make better decisions. And those decisions allow us to fly better, to get more passengers at their destinations on time, to be a better airline. That is for us the real goal. It's about actually impacting our operations, our passengers. The nice thing about this development at KLM is that once we started doing this, it pays off. It actually pays off. That's very nice. What's more importantly, it pays off tremendously. And that's a very cool thing, to be in a place where we get to use this technology and to see how much differences make. And it constantly drives us to take the next step and do it to get the maximum value of our data even more, and to be the best airline that we can be. My name is Maarten Oosten. I'm head of development at Operations Decision Support, and I'm responsible for machine learning, operations research, and using these solutions integrally for the KLM operations, the fun side of KLM that actually flies. A little bit about KLM. KLM is almost 100 years old now, and we are the oldest airline in the world flying under its own name, and we are very proud of this. We transport 40 million passengers a year. We have 32,000 employees working every day to make every flight a success and to make every experience you have with us memorable and positive. So actually, compared to the Netherlands and how large airlines usually are, KLM is very large. It's a very complex organization where we have all kinds of departments looking after all kinds of different aspects of every flight. I'm not going to explain what all these are, but what I will tell you is that it has to come together the moment the plane departs, all perfectly. Years of preparation, years of training, of training our crew, of developing our systems. It all has to work hundreds of times a day perfectly. Otherwise, things go wrong, people arrive too late, etc. How do we do this? How do we improve on this? How do we get the best decisions out there? First of all, we need data. And this is something we didn't used to be very good at. You're all data scientists. I'm not sure if you've ever had a problem getting access to a database, permission to read data, or you've been waiting for authorizations or for another team to make a connector that you can actually use. We decided enough with all that. We want all our data always automatically real-time available so that if we need to improve something, need to fix something, need to develop something, we can start not tomorrow, but now. Dan, who will also speak today, will tell you a bit how we've implemented this. The fun thing is that this is very hard, but we got to do this. We got to start on this, and that's very nice to be part of a movement where we can liberate actually all our data and actually make sure that we always get the value out of it. How do we get the values out of it? Well, we use optimizers, we use machine learning, we use analytics, we build apps on these platforms. And I will get in a bit more detail about that. But today, of course, we're going to look at machine learning. One part, how am I for time?
5 minutes.
5 minutes, okay. I will skip this a little bit. This is a view of our operations, where constantly we are preparing 5 years in advance our schedule. And as we prepare it, it moves closer to the now, where we are actually flying. After that, we make our crew rosters, we prepare our ground operations, we prepare our baggage operations, we prepare outstations, and all of these preparations are done again in more detail in later stages, and all this preparation is consumed. This all contributes to making every flight a success. But our operation is very variable. There's always changes. We have bad weather. We have passengers being delayed. We have passengers that are early. We have missing baggage. We have baggage that we know that arrives late. We have aircraft that have defects. This is all very hard to plan in advance. So to make the real best decision at this time, when we actually need it, we have to prepare for that. And the only way to do that is to know the future. So that's what we want. That's what we've set out to do. We must know the future to make the perfect decision at the perfect time. Here's one example, our passenger forecast, which is an aspect of what we'll talk about today, where we say the moment we know exactly how our passengers will behave, how many to expect, how many will be delayed, then we can make optimal decisions here. And that makes a big difference for our operations. We want to, in the end, we are working on making all aspects of our operations known beforehand as much as our data allows. What I just said. So here is a short overview of some of the tools we are making. We have optimization tools, we have prediction tools. The optimization tools allow us to make the best decisions based on our data. The prediction tools and machine learning models give us more data, give us better insights to make those decisions at every moment. And together we are making, we are really transforming the way we do business. Today we will talk about MOPS, but I will show one other example for the moment. That is our Pathfinder tool, where we here have something very simple. Two aircraft, one is flying to München and then flying to Copenhagen. The other aircraft will first fly to Manchester and then to Madrid. Yeah, Tom, this is something you helped make for us. But we know from our delay prediction that there's a big delay, chance of delay, on the München flight. And when it gets back at Schiphol, it's not going to be able to depart in time for our Copenhagen flight. Knowing this, we optimize. We switch them around. We use a different aircraft for the later two flights. Passengers are not affected, but here they will be on time because now we have enough time to handle the delayed flight, to allow the passengers to disembark, to board the passengers for the next flight. And this all happens because we make a single switch. This benefits KLM, and this benefits all our passengers who are now on time. And when we do this, not once, but we do this thousands of times every day, the impact is huge. And we achieve being one of the most punctual airlines in Europe. So that's it for my introduction. Are there any questions now, or do we all do this later?
Let's move on for now.
Okay, sure. Then let's look at KLM Catering Services, and I want to ask Joyce Morre to come forward and tell us about MOPS. Dis vooruit, en die rode is pointer.
Okay.
En dan krijg je natuurlijk deze van mij. Zo.
No. Where to put it? Okay, I'll hold it. So, hi everyone. My name is Joyce. I'm one of the product owners of the project MOPS. And I would like to take you through the project, but from a business perspective. In general, we are operating around 360 flights a day. And on these flights, we supply meals, snacks, drinks as a complimentary service. So at KLM In-Flight Services, our daily business is actually to deliver our customer promise. So we are trying to deliver the correct amount of meals to the aircraft in order to satisfy our customer with a meal on board. And in order to do so, it's really important that we know how many passengers will board a flight. So therefore, a correct passenger or accurate passenger forecast is really crucial in our process, as most of the steps in between are dependent on the passenger forecast. So we have some different moments before departure where this passenger forecast is used. First, we do some sourcing, some raw material sourcing. So we need the equipment and the raw materials. We do 2 days before departure, we start with the base production, so actually the base tray setup for example, our intercontinental flights. And, well, these are main blocks. We do more steps, but these are the main blocks. The last moment that's closer to departure, we do some adjustments. So we receive a new updated forecast in which we can make adjustments to make sure that the right amount of meals will be delivered to the aircraft. Actually, we were having a passenger forecasting system, so why did we want to replace it in the first place? Because we did have something. First of all, to reduce cost, because the passenger forecasting system that we had was supplied by an external, provided by an external supplier. So by replacing it by an in-house developed system, we would be able to eliminate the license cost that we had with the external supplier. Second, we wanted to increase the flexibility. So we want to make adaptations or changes much quicker to the process, being able as business to give some weight to a certain moment in time for forecast. We also wanted to improve our accuracy. So we wanted to have a superior performance, and we wanted to make use of state-of-the-art big science technology. And last, the data security, and that actually means that we wanted to have the storage of our data in-house rather than having it at an external party. So, last year, July, we introduced MOPS. And MOPS stands for Meals on Board System. And that's an in-house developed system with many people, great people. And we were able to deliver the meals to the aircraft more accurately by implementing this system. And it's called Meals on Board System and not Passenger Forecast System. But what we do is we collect the flight data. This is Mickey Mouse, of course. My colleagues will explain this better than I can do. But we collect the flight data. The algorithm provides us eventually the passenger forecast. And this passenger forecast is sent to our caterer. And the caterer translates this forecast into the number of meals. So we have learned in this project that it's really important to have a name close to what to the processes the end user is working with. And people working at the factory or the caterer are not working with passengers, they're working with meals. So that's why I decided to name the application after Meals on Board.
It's a good acronym as well.
So the approach. So how did we do this? Actually, there were some basic project phase elements that you all might recognize. I will point out some phases that we went through. There were a lot of ideas to actually improve the old system which we had before, but there were also ideas to replace it and to develop it in-house. And the data scientist had created a proof of concept. So they have shown a model to the business which already showed a better performance than the one that we at that time currently have. Based on that proof of concept, we created the business case. So did all the drawbacks of the old system were to be eliminated? Was it financially attractive and stuff like that? A very important phase, the MVP. So what were the requirements to go live? The business was going to work with a new system. So when would it be acceptable for them to replace the old one? When were they feeling confident enough to say goodbye to the old system and accept the new one? So not only for businesses was important, of course also for the data engineers and data scientists to know the boundaries of what the new system should look like. Then we started productionizing, so working on the proof of concept, improving it, getting the model in the right place. And then after that phase, we decided to have a go, no-go decision. There was a shadow mode implemented, so we were running the two systems at the same time to show, okay, how does the current system working and how is the improved version working? And that created enough confidence for business to see the difference between the two of them. And that's why we went live. So it was a really a good achievement. We were really happy that we were able to eliminate all the drawbacks from the old system, and that that business was confident enough to take this big step, because we were having this other system already for 14 years. So after 14 years, suddenly there's a big data science thingy that business doesn't understand, but yeah, you need to, find the confidence and to accept it, and they did, based on, of course, a good product, and based on the acceptance criteria that we selected in the first place. So now we are more into the continuous improvement phase. So we're continuously improving the model based on the data we have, based on expert insights, based on operations. So operations, as in people from the caterer, are giving us feedback on how things are going there. And with that information, we're trying to update the model as much as possible to achieve at least the optimized loadings that we want with this new forecast system. Because that is, at the end, something that we would like to achieve, optimize loadings and make decisions, better decisions at the end of the process. Who did we need for that? So first of all, of course, the business stakeholders, they were there to define the requirements and the needs, of course. There were some product owners involved, including myself, but also some others from the technical teams or from ODS. And they were there to be there as timekeeper, keeper of control the project goal, and really important to make the bridge between the business and the data scientist. Because it's really important that, and in our project, the data scientists did a really good job, that they translate the business needs into a technical solution. Because for business, all the algorithm, data science topics are really vague. They only can tell them what they need. And it's really important that the data scientist could really define the underlying need from business in order to make a really nice solution. Then, of course, also the data engineers. So, translate that into a technical working system, as in how is it working under the hood? I don't know the details of that, but they did a really good job, because it's a system that is perfectly functioning. And we needed a solution architect to have the overall guardian of as the for the technical solution. So we have different components within the technical solution which should communicate to each other, and there we needed a keeper as well. The Mickey Mouse version of what we created, my colleagues, as I said, will explain a bit more into detail. So we have the data sources, which are going into a database. And from that database, the algorithm is going to give us the PAX forecast, the passenger forecast, sorry. And what important is here is that we have two components. So this is really about the data and the data database. But what the end user is seeing is going through the MOPS application, because we needed to add some business ruling. And I can give you an example. This application is mostly used by our caterer in Amsterdam Schiphol here. So we needed to apply some business rules, such as only send passenger forecasts for flights departing from Amsterdam, stuff like that. This is the general part. This is the more business specific part, where we can actually apply these business rules. On this application, we have a web interface, so a view of on the website where the end user can actually see the passenger forecast. And at the end, it's going to be sent to the caterer, so they have it in their own system and they have the web page where they can see the forecast. This is how it looks like. So for every flight, every day, business economy class, we are sending the PAX capacity, the booked passengers, and the forecast. All information that is gathered in this database, we can also show to the end user. And that's also on different moments of time. So here you see an example of 4 hours before departure forecast. Some results, of which I'm really proud of. So the lag coverage, what I mean is the previous system was sending forecasts, but we were not able to send the forecast, on every flight lag. So sometimes the caterer was missing some passenger forecasts, and that created manual work. So we want to improve that, and we want to say to every end user, don't worry, the passenger forecast is there anytime. Congratulations, we managed. So that was really a really nice result. So there's almost, there's a little manual work on that. Another good result is that we have improved forecasts, and basically it's that we have less errors, less forecast errors, less deviation, so the process is more stable. That's actually what this says, is we have a more stable process, and that means that there, especially at the end of the process, close to departure, there's not a lot of deviation, so not a lot of movements on the platform. Our biggest challenges during this project, but because we faced some challenges as well. The first one, data-driven way of working, which was new. The data that we needed for this forecast model was not available yet. So ODS did a great job in getting this information and getting the data in order to get the passenger forecast. Overcome skepticism. A new system means a cultural change. People have been working for 14 years with another system. It's in their system. It's literally in their system. It's in their blood. So changing it is really complex. So that was a huge challenge for business. And also, the customer should not be impacted. Operations must go on. So with this go live, nothing should have gone wrong, because the meals should be delivered every flight, every day. So this go live the date, it was really important. And it was also a challenge. How did we succeed and overcome these challenges? The team, of course. There was a bridging team, so everyone took their role. And as I said, everyone understood the requirements very well, so that the technical solution could be created based on the inside need from business. One change at a time. This was to overcome the skepticism that we had. People that have been working with a system and not have been working with data science before can only have one, well, in general, can only have one change at a time. But it was really important that we did it step by step, did a phased go live plan, and that people get used to the way of the new algorithm was thinking and providing them the passenger forecast. Take ownership and co-create. Well, as KLM, we needed to take the ownership of our new passenger forecast. We needed to provide the support, the technical support, the functional support, the business support. So everything had to be in place. And the co-create part. So the name of this application is actually that was created, or yeah, someone found it from the caterer. So we really wanted to involve the end user in the process, because it helped us in the acceptance of the new system. And soft skills, be patient. That's something that's really important, especially when everything is new. Then it's really important to be patient and make sure that everything goes step by step. So what's next? Because we have a really nice new system. So we are investigating new opportunities to share our passenger forecast to other stakeholders in the supply chain, but also to think of consumption pattern forecasting. So there are a lot of things that we are working on. So we're back to the ideation phase, and then our input is MOPS, and we're trying to create new things in order to improve our loadings and eliminate all the things that we don't like in the process. Yep. So thank you.
Thanks, Joyce.
Questions or?
Yeah, let's do one or two quick questions.
I was just wondering how long did the process take in from ID to productionizing?
Okay, so I'll repeat the question. How long did the whole project take from ID to execution? Right. The ID phase was, I think, a couple of months. The data scientists were, I think, around half a year maybe, working on it already. And then the proof of concept started, and that was 9 months. So I think 1.5 years, something like that. It took 1.5 years to complete the whole process. Oh, there are more than one question.
How many people it was?
So I need to think of this. Maybe some of you can help me.
It's two, like 4 or 5 data engineers, 4 or 5, and
two data scientists.
And the MOPS team itself that created the app. I don't know.
Yeah, that we were with 7 in total, including the functional application manager and stuff like that. So we were in 7. So 14, around 14, 15.
Somewhere. Yeah.
Yeah. No, this was not full time. No, for some of us it was something that we needed to do next to our regular job.
Okay,
yeah.
Great.
Okay,
thanks,
thank
Joyce.
You. Go ahead. Oh, ik had je even moeten introduceren.
All right, on to the data science. So I'm Alexander. I'm a data scientist at Big Data Republic. I was also data science tech lead on this project, so project consultant on on this project with KLM. So we've seen the phases: ideate, experiment, industrialize. These are basically the usual phases that a data science product goes through. And I will talk mainly about this phase, the experiment phase, so the proof of concept, and also a bit about deploying it in shadow mode, shadow deployment, we call it, about the algorithms, methods, challenges, solutions, etc. So let's go. Oh, if you have any questions, we do that after the talk, if there's still some time left, or during the break. And so if we want to start doing a proof of concept or an experiment, we need to first dive into the data value chain. So what is the data value chain? It starts with value. You go through it backwards. So you go through it, we go through it to that way. And we start with the value. So what is the value here? The business objectives. We want to have optimal catering. We want to make sure we don't have too many meals, and also not too few meals on board. And we want to have also that the customer is not having to wait before we supply extra meals. We want to reduce cost of waste, etc. So optimal catering, in short. That is, we can do that by taking the right actions. And what actions do we have? We have our end user. We have Joyce representing the business, so KLM Catering Services. They make the final call. What do we supply to this aircraft? And we can influence that action using data science, because here we have our insight, and that insight is used to decide on the number of meals that we put on board. And then and that is actually our value proposition. So what kind of insight do we want to deliver? We want to show passenger forecast to the end user so that they can make data-driven decision and get to optimal catering. And here at the far left of the data value chain is data. So what we use to make this insight is we use the data. So this is the data value chain. And it is essential to really understand it fully before you can start an experiment. We call this refinement, basically. So we need to dive deeper also now in our value proposition, so our passenger forecast. Zoom in on this spot. Okay, so first, let me reiterate the business process a bit. So we want to predict the number of passengers that will board a flight. So we have a departure moment, that's you see that here on the timeline, and we have some planning moments, like for ordering or last minute just-in-time adjustment, these kind of things. We have, at that planning moment, we want to know how many passengers will board that flight. And there's a thing here, we have multiple planning moments, and that can be different for different flights, so we have so-called horizons for forecasting, different ones. We have short-term, longer-term, up to 2 weeks. So this brings us to the requirements of the insight or the system that we need to make to produce this insight. The first one is we want to have, for each upcoming flight, so flight in the future, not for the past, obviously, at any moment for departure, so I basically loosened it up a bit, so I said just for any moment before departure in a certain window, we want to have this accurate as possible passenger forecast. And what does accurate mean here? That's, of course, open for a bit more debate, and I will come back to that later on in the talk. So how do we design a system? Well, here's still slightly Mickey Mouse-ish version, but we get more and more into detail. So we have some flight and booking data, we'll talk about in a moment. We have our machine learning algorithm that will make this prediction, and there we have our passenger forecast as an insight. Then we have actually our what we call the actual or target. So it's basically a boarded passengers that we know after each flight how many passengers have boarded. And that's sort of our ground truth. So we know how many passengers boarded. We also know how much we forecasted. But we can use this in a feedback loop to feed it back into our data and then use it to train this machine learning algorithm. That's how it will work. Oh, there. Little bit lag. So in mathematical formulation, we have some axis, which is the light blue there, our data. And we have our Y, which is our boarded passenger, our target. And then we say in machine learning jargon, like FX is equals Y. That's the model we want to make. We want to learn this F, this function that transforms the data into a number of booked passengers, or forecasted passengers, sorry. So what should be output of this system? Well, one thing we can do, and this is, so here, we could do conditional density estimation. We could say, hey, what is the probability for a certain number of passengers on the flight? So how would that look? Well, we have on the x-axis here the number of passengers that we predict, and on the y-axis we have a low or high probability of that being happening. And then we can estimate something like this and say, okay, well, probably there will be, and that's what we then call like the expectation, the like 100 passengers on board of this flight. And we can also use these quantiles to make like uncertainty estimates. This, however, is also a bit overkill. Remember what Joyce said in terms of start simple, one step at a time. And that's also what we did in this project. So this can be a very nice way to extend a model that we like this. And I actually talked about that in PyData. It's PyData Amsterdam 2018. Also technical conference. There's also a YouTube video online about how to do this in this case. But for now, it's actually too much. So because the actual business process was used to a single number. So we'll get back to that. So you have basically the requirements for your minimal viable product. And then out of that, you have your new functionalities that you should not do. So no scope creep, start simple. So you want to minimize the need for change management. So we go back to our process. So we have this action here where the end user catering supplies the meals to the aircrafts, so the supply chain process. And then we note that the current process, or at least like before we replaced it, is based on the number of expected passengers, so a single number that is used to determine how many meals should be on board. So then we can look at our problem at hand. So we can really finalize framing the problem. So we think we have a continuous variable, the number of passengers that will board the aircraft, and we're just going to do a textbook regression kind of approach to it. So we want to predict this y, this continuous variable. So now we look a bit into the data. Let's see how I'm on time. It's good. So what kind of data do we use? The inputs to our system. What's the first thing you think of? Well, I gave it away, but it's the booked passengers. Of course, there's the number of passengers that have booked a ticket. That's, of course, the single most important variable to a passenger forecasting system we can think of. And then now I hear you all thinking, like, hey, is that not the same as the forecasted passengers? So why do we make this model? Well, in theory, it might be the case, but it's actually not. Why? We have these last-minute bookings. We also have delayed passengers that cannot make their flight for any reason, also called no-shows. And we have also aircraft changes, so sometimes an aircraft gets upgraded or downgraded, etc. There's like there's stuff going on in the operations world that makes that the booked passengers are not always the same as the stuff that the amount of passengers that will board. So instead, we use various data sources. And for the proof of concept, we used from these various data sources, we made historical dumps. So we took the history and basically extracted it and put it in an experimental environment where we could run our experiments. And these were main classes were basically, so the bookings, so booking numbers, we do want to have them. Also, characteristics of the aircraft, capacity, blocked seats, all kinds of things of the aircraft. The location, so where is the aircraft departing from, where is it going, these kind of characteristics. Is it an intercontinental flight or a European flight? Makes a big difference. And also features related to the time of departure. Is it a morning flight, an evening flight, etc. On a Wednesday, a Saturday, it's very important. So these are the main system inputs. And note that it's very important that the solution that we make is able to handle interactions between all these variables. So for instance, if the date is on a holiday and the booking number is quite low, then you could see that there's a lot of last minute bookings going on. So there's these interactions, if this, then that, going on in our variables, to be able to accurately model the number of passengers that will board the flight. So keep that in mind. Get back to that. On the multiple horizons, we can say the following. So traditionally, what you would do is you would make one model for each horizon. So you say, okay, I want to predict 2 weeks ahead, I make one model. Then I make another model that predicts 4 hours. ahead. Here we took a different approach because we wanted to predict for any moment in advance, to make it very general, very extensible. We fit one model where we basically add temporal indicators. So we say how far before departure are we? So there's one input to the model which says we're now 4 hours before departure. We're now 6.3 hours before departure. Also, supply chain management can use it as a sort of just-in-time forecast. So the latest forecast they can use in their process. And how is that relation? Well, this is simulated data. And in general, it's such that the closer you get to departure, the higher the booking number, obviously. But that's so hours to departure. We also call it query moment, when we query the forecasting system. Then the target. So now we're grabbing all the pieces for our machine learning problem frame. So we want to define a target. I said we were interested in the number of passengers that will board the flight. Well, you can do something clever here. So you can basically say, I want to only predict the offset or the difference with the current booking number. And that helps the algorithm to basically get a leg up, because it doesn't need to learn then also this offset. So it can just predict, okay, plus 10 or minus 4. So it doesn't need to learn then that it's now already at 140 passengers, for instance. So how does that look? Here we have our boarded passengers. Then we have a variable that goes into our system, which is the booked passengers, and we basically take the difference. And that's our surrogate target that we try to learn with our machine learning solution. And that way, so like I explained, the model can focus on learning interactions between the booking numbers. Accuracy. So I talked about accuracy, want accurate forecast. What do we mean with accuracy? Well, we can define at several levels metrics. And the business level, and there we have customer satisfaction or cost reduction, waste reduction. But also on a user level, so then we look more at what this end user is really focusing on, such as oversupply, undersupply, the number of last minute adjustment that needs to be done, etc. And we have model metrics that for the data scientists are interested in, like mean squared error. But in this case, we focused on the mean absolute error. Why the mean absolute error? It's closely related to the business goals. And ideally, in a case like this, what you want to have is basically a metric that really captures the business cost in a single value. But it's often very difficult to get this metric because it's a very complex process that you're hooking into. And so getting all these variables like, okay, these meals go with like a pack of 10 per time, and a business class meal is more expensive than an economy class. There's a lot of complications and intricacies in this process. So that we choose to look at absolute error also because our business is also, our supply chain is also used to this metric and knows how to roughly translate this into real business impact. So that's what we supply them with, or we try to optimize. So how does it look? Here we have our boarded passengers, and on the other side we have our forecasts. Then we just take the absolute difference. So it's simple as that. You're probably all familiar with that. So that's mean absolute error. But it's not enough. Like I said, there's differences between economy, business class, so we need slices. So we slice according to cabin class. We look at economy class differently than business class. And also for flight groups. So there's a difference in the impact on the business process for European flights and for intercontinental flights. So European flights can go back and forth catering, intercontinental only go one way, or vice versa. Maybe I'm messing things up here, but there's this nuances in the process which make them very different. So these are the icons, they just fade in. But also there's a third axis we want to know, the hours to departure. So for these different query moments, we want to look how well is it over time. And there, basically, you can assume that the further away, so the farther away your horizon is, the higher the error. That's the general process. The closer you get to departure, the lower the error. So they have different impact on the business process. So that's what we also see if we look at them. What are the kind of plots, the visualizations that we show to our stakeholders? It's kind of like this. So we have a window. So on the x-axis, you see time before departure, hours to departure. On the y-axis, the error. And here we have departure moment. And we have two windows. We have a more short-term window, like the day of departure. And we have a more longer-term window, like for production and ordering moments. So they act on different timescales. And here you see this generic pattern where you see the mean absolute error going down, 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 the closer you get to the departure moment. What we also look at is the spread of the forecast, because if it's very like unstable or there's it's asymmetric, so there's a lot of undersupply instead of oversupply or vice versa, it can also have a different impact on the business. So we also supply these residual plots where we basically make a histogram, and here I made also a smooth line on top of it, where you say, okay, everything that's in here is zero, it's perfect forecast, you want to have it centered on there. Everything on the left side is an undersupply because we forecasted too little, and everything on the right side is an oversupply. So, and this is a nice symmetrical residual plot. So it means that the amount of oversupply is more or less the same as the amount of undersupply. And that's what you want. Or you want to maybe also balance it one way or another. With this kind of techniques, we can do that. So, and then we look at these plots for the different slices. So Europe, economy, intercontinental, etc. So, but we don't, of course, do these plots that I just showed you on the data that we also built the algorithm on. That's not allowed, so we do that with a proper validation procedure. So how do we do that? We have our full historical data set, was a couple of years of data that we use. And there we split it in two, with a so-called rolling window. So we basically split the last part, the most recent part of the data, that's becoming our test set. That's the final holdout set that we use to make these metrics, these plots that we present to business. So the temporal split is always the cleanest split of your data that you can make, because there's no way that information from this side, from the future, can leak into your training data for your model. So this, the light blue is basically where we train our machine learning algorithm on. So the temporal split is the cleanest one you can do. And then you can basically do a rolling window, so you can say, okay, I shift my training window more and more into the future, and then evaluate it on multiple of these splits. But it's also kind of an expensive split procedure of your data. So note that if you do this, you need at least a whole year to basically able to validate seasonalities. If you split only the month April in your test set, then you have no idea how well your algorithm performs on Christmas days. So this is kind of expensive. Also, this rolling window procedure, you need to train a lot of models if you want to make it very fine grained. So if you want to do a lot of these splits, then you need to do also a lot of training your model. So what we chose also secondary to that, that's what you usually see. So we have a third set, which is called the validation set. That's what we use to tune our machine learning model. We use a random split for that. And therefore, we just take basically random pieces from that this half and put them either in this training data where we base our model on, or the validation set where we basically tune hyperparameters and check whether we are going in the right direction. But this guy here is always really clean. It's the temporal split that we use for validation with business. Yeah, and this allows for quite quick iterations, because you can sample multiple days from the same year and put them either in your validation or test set. What we did here is we did it grouped style. That's because you need at least to make sure that you don't put two flights that are on the same day, one of them in here, one of them in here, because then you know that the algorithm can learn that there was a big disturbance on that day and then predict it easily in this validation set. So you need to do a grouped shuffled split at minimum for this kind of procedure. We do it multiple times, so we do multiple folds. And I can show you in the code a little later on. All right. Oop, oh no, I didn't want to. It's lagging. I had an interactive question. So this sort of data set is kind of tabular. So we have flights as rows. We have this booked number. We also have the boarded number. And Pax is airline jargon for passengers. We have the capacity. We have a bunch of other variables that we create from that. So now we want to have something, and I already spoiled it, that can cut through this data frame and learn patterns from it. And we could use stuff like deep learning. Also for that, I refer to this PyData talk. Here, we wanted to have something fast and simple. And actually, what you can use then is this well-known algorithm called gradient boosting decision trees. And this is really good at handling this type of tabular data, this type of mixed type data with a lot of categorical data or numerical data, doesn't matter. There's almost no assumptions for this model. So like it's fully parametric, so it can fit any distribution that you want. Can handle complex interactions. So I'll show you in a moment, for those of you who are not familiar with it, how it works. But it can basically make all these kind of if-else statements. So if the booking number is very high, but it's holiday, then this, and if else, then that. Also, it is relatively fast, so it can you can on a reasonably well-equipped machine, you can run a lot of these models and iterate very fast on it. So it's very very good go-to algorithm, basically. I will now outline how this algorithm works for those of you who are not familiar with it. First, to do that, we need to look into the basic building block of gradient boosting decision trees, which is the decision tree. So what we do is we train a decision tree to minimize the mean absolute error of our training data, so to predict the boarded passengers as good as possible. Then, here we have some example training data. Then we can create this decision tree. So it might, for instance, learn a split. So it might learn the optimal split, maybe something like booking numbers higher than 120, true or false. And if it's false, then it goes in here. That's called a leaf. So every node, every sample that's in this leaf will basically contribute to the final prediction. So here, -2. But it can also go the other way, and then it says, for instance, hey, if the holiday is true, then you should go there, +10. If it's false, then +6. This kind of patterns the decision tree can learn. It's not tree, it's trees, it's decision trees, because it's a tree ensemble algorithm. So we use multiple of these instances, and we're going to average them. So here's our previous tree. And what we then do is we learn a second tree. May learn something completely different. So like the destination is New York, so something else. And then we take the average of those trees. So in this for this light blue example, it's 6 minus 1 because it's in here. And then the final output of the model will be 5. Then there's one missing piece of the puzzle, which is gradient boosting. So gradient boosting is a technique where you can basically home in on mistakes that the algorithm makes. And this is a technique, it's gradient boosting because it can work for any differentiable loss function like the mean absolute error. What we do is we take this previous tree that we have and say that our target was this, -4, -6, -10, 0 for these examples, these toy examples. Then if you look at this one here, there's some error there because it predicts -2, which means that for this one, it's not enough. Here it's too many. So like that. And then what we do is we have our second tree, which will then learn exactly how to correct the mistakes that the previous one made. That's called boosting. And then we do this averaging trick again. And note that it is a sequential process. So we first need to do one, and then we can do two. So it takes a bit more time than, for instance, random forest algorithm, which is very similar to this one. But it allows to have zoom in on these mistakes that it makes, and therefore it can learn a lot of, it's highly sensitive to any pattern that is in the data. It can learn very quickly. So in the code, and it's kind of trivial, but there's this package. It's called LightGBM. It's a version of Microsoft that Microsoft made of this algorithm. It's open source. It has a scikit-learn API, so you can just import it like that. What we then do is here we make basically a pipeline. What we can do is we put in our own little fancy custom pre-processing class, and then in the end we hook up this LightGBM regressor object. And we just put in a bunch of estimators. We do thousands of these iterations. I will just show why this is. We put in our loss function, our mean absolute error. So that's regression L1, mean absolute error. Then, very handy and cool, is you can specify categorical features. So then if you throw in a data frame, a pandas data frame, then it can immediately recognize which ones are categoricals and process them in the correct way. And there's also an option here for use missing, which means that you have missing values like NAs, like missing values in your data. It can also handle that and learn whether to split them to the right or put them into the left or to the right of the tree. So for each missing value. So it's really good. It handles them out of the box. And then we fit it to our training data, X and Y, with some additional parameters. Come back in a moment. So what happens if we... it was faster than on that screen. But so we want to tune this algorithm. There's one big problem with this algorithm, because if we keep on doing this boosting trick, so we keep on zooming in on mistakes, then a certain thing will happen, and we're all familiar with it. It's called overfitting, and it's very comparable to making a very deep decision tree. So because what you basically do is each iteration is homing in on a lot of small mistake, and it can dedicate as much splits as it wants to fit every outlier. So you get something like the green line. So if this is our truth, but then we want to also to fit this smooth line, but then if it goes overfitting, it's going to basically go to all these outliers. And that's a model that doesn't generalize well to the real world, to the future. So we want to make sure this doesn't happen. How do we do that? So one way to do it is using shrinkage factor, and that's explained here. So if we look at the next tree, YT, then we look at the previous tree plus, and then we multiply the new tree with a certain factor. So that means that every successive tree will get less power to influence the prediction. And so it gets less and less, it shrinks basically. And that and that also keeps it in check basically. So you cannot use the full power to fit all these outliers, so to say. And then there's another trick which is called early stopping. And here this validation set comes in handy. So we have this third set that we split it off. There we can look at whether if we do these iterations, like these 1,000 trees that I input as a parameter, then we see, of course, our training loss on the data set that is used to train the algorithm. It goes down, it gets better and better, but then the validation loss plateaus at some point, and that's the moment where we do early stopping. There we stop the algorithm. So that's why it doesn't matter if we say we put 1,000 trees. We just stop whenever the algorithm has learned the best it can at that point. So then there's another set of other hyperparameters. So we have some parameters that are mostly due to affect the basically pruning. So when the tree is stopped growing, which is basically the number of leaves that it can have. In this case, it was 3, or the max depth. There's these kind of parameters. And there's also variables that affect the splitting. So for instance, feature fraction means that for each successive tree, you sample, bootstrap sample, so with replacement, a number of features, so it can only learn from a subset of the features, basically. Sorry for this one, it's with Bootstrap, and I don't know for that. Anyway, details. Then to find the optimal settings of the hyperparameters, we use something called sequential model-based optimization, where we model the expected improvement given a set of hyperparameters. This works as follows. So it's better than random search. If you have two hyperparameters, 1 and 2. Then you can use this package called HyperOpt, which implements this tree of parsing estimator, which is an estimator or a model that does exactly this. And it basically boils down to the following. So if the darkness of the color here indicates how good the model is, so the darker the better, then there will be more sampling of the hyperparameter settings in the regions where there's a high reward, where there's a high score. Yeah, so this really makes your process a lot more efficient finding the optimal settings. So you have a balance between exploitation and exploration. So because it will sample more here, it doesn't mean that this cannot be sampled. So it will also explore some other regions. And a fellow data scientist, Giovanni Gansnotti, sitting in the room, he did a great job in setting up this pipeline like really efficiently. We could do a lot of fast iterations and experimentation on this. Yeah, so how does this look? So we can import this package, HyperOpt. We can specify a search space, and we can do like the prior. So we can say, okay, the max depth, I want it to be somewhere between 3 and 12. and I want to sample from that, start from that. Or the learning rate is a log uniform distribution, which starts at 0.0001 and goes to whatever. So you can then set your prior. So that's where it will start out, but it will then learn where the most the high score is. Then you set up this loop, the evaluation function, where you say, okay, we input some parameters, and then what we do is we look at, these are some parameters that you can use for early stopping. You can also do this multifold cross-validation inside here. You say, okay, I set these parameters, and then I do the fitting, and I return the final score of this setting. And then all in the end, you need to, this is where it all comes together, you need to run X amount of trials of this. So you say, okay, I want to use this tree of Parson estimator, TPE, for 10 times. It's a bit low in reality. You would do basically the whole night or even longer. And I want to use this search space and this function to evaluate. So that's how, if you set up this machine like this and run it, it will start optimizing and find the best hyperparameters for a light GBM. And it can actually differ a lot in the accuracy. Okay, this works out. So this worked. It was an experiment which was successful. We could demonstrate it to business stakeholders. Great. But of course, only on the laptop. So now it's time for a real test. So we wanted to do the shadow deployment. But before I get to that, first I have to tell a bit about this, trimming the feature set, because you have to look what do we already have in the production platform. So Dan will talk more about that, but some features we wanted to collect in real time in the ODS data platform. Some of them we had already, others we didn't. They were an old legacy system. Then it's very, very good if, as a data scientist, you say, okay, look at which features are absolutely critical for this minimal viable product, for this proof of concept. And you can use the feature gain, basically how important or how much reduction in loss do you get for any of the features that you input and are used in the splits for the trees. And then you might find out that some of the features, like the notorious nice to haves, like weather data, more ticket information, traffic jams, all this stuff, is maybe adding like marginal returns, but you can add them always later in an improvement iteration. But for now, focus on the stuff that can easily get in production. So you could remove these kind of variables from your product. Then what we did is a bit like pre-production. We basically converted a whole set of Jupyter notebooks that we used to do these experiments. We converted them to Python packages. So then you get something like this with a nice project structure with everything in Python files where you say, okay, here's my model specified. Here's the script to train it, some settings, some dependencies, a nice script to set it all up. And of course, also the notebooks to be able to reproduce what the data scientist did. And also some unit tests to make sure that everything works as you expect. And this is enough to work together with the engineers to get a shadow deployment going. So what we there do is we predict on real-time production data. So we have our current system, the old system, it produces a forecast, users acting on it, supply chain process. We leave it untouched, so we don't do anything with it, but then in the shadows, we have this new data feed that is on the ODS KLM platform. Then we have our MOPS application, our MOPS prediction engine, forecast engine, producing these insights, these forecasts. And then the end user is basically scrutinizing it. So it will then check whether the coverage is good, whether the accuracy is good, etc. So, but the process is unaffected. So you can really do this in the shadow. And after that, decide whether the requirements for go live are met and basically go live. There was also in this phase, and that's what I want to show you, a challenge, which is called the training serving queue, which basically means that the data that where you trained your algorithm on is not the same as the data that you get in production, real time. It sounds a bit weird, but yeah, just trust me, there were different data sources, like in the ODS platform, what we did is we did it right. We collect event data. I think Dan can talk more about that. And we want to know, use that as a source for our model. But there was a difference between what we had in our historical data dump. So for some variables, we saw that old should be new, so it should be on this line, but there was actually this kind of pattern, where there were differing values between the data that we use for training the model and also the data that we collect in real time in production. And this is mostly due to timing differences, sometimes also semantics. But most of those issues we solved using data engineering, but there were still some things left based on whatever factor. And for that, we also had a solution from data science, which is called residual learning. I have to credit Jan van de Vecht, he's there against the wall, for bringing this up, this idea. So it's really, really nice, I think. So what we do is we fit our first estimator, so our light GBM, based on the historical sources, XA. And we use also our target that we have in our database to get F1, our first estimator. Then we have a second estimator, residual estimator. And this one takes the new data, XB, and basically pulls it through the model. Then we get a forecast. But then it subtracts, basically, from this forecast. So you get a residual, something that is left, an error that needs to be corrected based on these differences in the data, in the input data. And there you train a secondary estimator, so F2. So F2 is trained on the residual of this and basically the original data. So it learns to correct the mistakes that the first model makes because it was trained on old data, on other data. The cool thing is you can also add in new stuff. So we had, because we collected all the events properly, we had a whole load of new extra data that we could use. Also what Joyce was saying, we want to improve the accuracy of the model with our own data. We have a lot more data than what we use for the old system. And actually, that's in dark blue. We can also feed it into train this guy here. Then the third step is when you want to make predictions, you basically go through the system all at once. So you first throw the light blue part, go in here. Then you throw the whole thing in here. And then say, okay, add these two together. And that's my final prediction. So that's a solution that can work really well if you have this problem. The nice thing is also you can use this to update your algorithm and extend it with more features here until you don't need this history anymore, because also you collect, of course, history in the new real-time system, new real-time platform. So, all right, so this worked out. And with all these efforts, we basically could beat the current system. So the current system in light blue, our system in dark blue. It was on every key moment that we agreed to with business. Was a better performance than what we had before. Also in terms of spread, like Joyce mentioned, the 70% decrease and 40% in spread. So it was proven superior performance. Which brings us to the final part of the product life cycle, industrialize. And there, Dan will talk more also about how basically this whole system works. Just to wrap up, takeaways. So this data value chain, so getting it, making it, understanding the business process, it's key for a project like that, for the data scientists to be able to frame the problem and translate a business need into a machine learning problem. Then, this kind of shadow deployment and whole like trajectory sketching really works in getting the business stakeholder committed. They can see the forecast, they can say, oh, it works, it has good coverage, oh, nice. And, oh, you use all these input data to make the better prediction. That's good, we want to have it. So it really helps you in getting commitment from your business stakeholders. And then final thing, and I also in regard to that everything I said on using gradient boosting instead of deep learning, trimming the features, etc., looking at expectation instead of the whole conditional density, all these things, you keep it simple, basically try to think minimal viable, and then when you have something, you can really iterate on it fast. So that's where the situation where we're in now. I think that's really nice. All right. These were the takeaways. So, thanks for your attention. Do we have time for questions? Yeah? All right, shoot. Yes.
Can you explain a bit more how you did this shuffling of your training?
So the question is, so if I could explain more about the shuffling of the training data. So yeah. And do you mean the group shuffle split for the validation
set? Exactly, because I didn't really understand.
In the beginning I said that the temporal split, so splitting off the most recent part, is always the cleanest one. But it's also expensive in terms of data. You need to have this complete window to train on, and then also a big enough window to validate on, because you want to see all the seasonalities throughout the year. So then this other way of splitting is basically taking your training data and then picking out days, a random set of days. So you can really fine-tune control how much days you put in this training data and how much days you put in this testing data. And then at least you sample some of them, some of the holidays also, and some of the across months. You also sample some days from January, some from February, so that you can then with a much smaller test set or validation set, you can still assess the performance of your algorithm, albeit not completely clean as the temporal split. So there's a bit of cheating going on then, but it doesn't matter because only for parameter tuning.
But you in your sampling, you still make sure that in the small sample, your test set was later than your train set.
No, not necessarily.
Did I phrase it correctly?
No. Yeah. So the train set was not always earlier than the test set. In these small samples.
Oh,
the real test was always in the future, yeah.
I'm talking about like the cross validation.
The cross validation. No, that was random. So also from the future. Yeah, because it's a lot more data efficient that way, and you use to do the final assessment. You use the clean temporal split.
But you still use future data when training the model.
Yeah, that's what you, yeah, sure. But that's what you normally also do when you have a big list of whatever kind of data. Also, when you train the model in itself, it's using future data to predict the past. So there's always this nuance.
But the big thing is you use the test set to actually simulate what it would be like if you run something in production. But with validation, you don't use the metrics that you get from your validation set to perform any analysis or that goes to the manager like, hey, we're going to meet this performance. But what you can do is that you can compare different hyperparameter settings. Hopefully that is in this way you're kind of interpolating between your data instead of extrapolating. But the hope is that at least it's highly correlated with how it would do on your test set so that you can much cheaper do evaluation on different hyperparameters.
So it's efficiency, computational efficiency kind of thing. But the final evaluation is always 100% clean. I hope that's clear. Okay, next question. Yes, please.
Are you also looking at the past flight data, like past load factor, for example? Because now I understood you only look at bookings.
No, load factors is also like what we call a derived or augmented feature. So that's one that is composed out of an input. Like you have a capacity input and you have a booking number input, and then you can make a load factor from that, basically. Of historical flight, the load factor. We also played with a lot of lag data, so looking at the previous flights and what was there. And we saw that most of the signal is, so this is again, it's very difficult to get such a feature in production. It's more engineering work, and it has a marginal gain in this sense. But it was also something that we can use, I don't know what the current state, but we can use as another input, yeah, definitely. I saw something in the one in the back.
Playing a 10% game here, right? So we're optimizing for a 10% weight, which is still probably tens of millions of money, but that's the scope, that's the maximum gain we can get here, because we could also always load the plane with the number of seats. That's about a 10% average maximum gain of the project. That's probably correct, but the other question more important.
Okay, I was trying to reiterate it, but it's still a lot of money. The question is that if you can only reduce because flights get usually fully booked or in many cases then there's a little margin, it's still very worth it to look into that. That's the conclusion. Yeah.
You don't have the right inputs for that, because then you would actually need some input on the likelihood of planes swapping.
Yeah, so the question is that swapping is very unpredictable for this algorithm and has a large impact on the number of passengers that will fly, which is true, but that's why we have basically all the data in one place. And this is actually an input that you can feed, like, was it swapped, or what? We know afterwards that an aircraft is swapped. We can use that to basically, an algorithm can learn then that there might be a probability of a swap going on. We actually saw these kind of things, saw these kind of patterns in this version of the algorithm already with capacity swap. So that a bigger aircraft, and then it already predicted that there would be a no cap on the max capacity because there would be a bigger aircraft. So we already saw these kind of learnings from this algorithm, but I think because at ODS we have all the data at one place, there's much opportunity for also including this kind of input features to the prediction algorithm. Yes, thank you. Final question, you pick.
And you spend some time in setting up cross-validation to improve performance, like picking out the subset of data. Did you consider different implementations like XGBoost instead of LightGBM?
Yeah, so XGBoost and LightGBM. So the question is whether we consider different implementation, XGBoost, LightGBM. We actually tried both, so the answer is yes. LightGBM was at the moment when we were playing around it, they're going like, they're kind of the implementations of the same algorithm, yeah. The same kind of algorithm. One is from Microsoft, the other one is from another group. And at that point that when we used it, also LightGBM was the first one that had good categorical support. So the optimal way to split a category is by making like a binary split and then making buckets of multiple categories in one bucket. So A and D and C can go that way, and B and E go that way. And XGBoost at that point was only able to split off one hot encoded feature. So basically then you can only split off one feature at a time, or you use two splits to split off one feature if you don't one hot encoded. So there was the optimal way to handle categorical data in LightGBM, which was the main reason why we chose it. But they are kind of interchangeable. You're right. So we played around with both of them. Yeah. All right. Thanks for all the questions.
Yeah. Time for a short break, and then we'll reconvene in 10 to 15 minutes.
stream. Now you should be able to hear me. So sorry about that. So we thought of like, let's do a slightly better way. And this was before the whole mobs thing, right? So we thought, okay, we can do this better. So we set out to build a system called Flight 720. Flight 720 is basically the, let's say, the operational data heart of KLM operations. So it is a real-time data system which receives all kinds of different events from all kinds of backend systems from KLM and constructs, let's say, some kind of ground truth from this. It contains information about flight legs, about passengers, about baggage. Basically, in real time, like, what is the status of this bag right now? What can you tell me about this passenger right now? What can you tell me about this flight leg right now? I will go into the details of the Flight 720 architecture later on because it's of utmost importance to the whole prediction business. So what we do is we not only does Flight 720 create this ground truth, we also put in the database of Flight 720, we store predictions. And we serve these predictions through the Flight 720 API. The nice thing is that Flight 720, unlike the system that I talked about before, Flight 720 is actually 24/7 supported. You can actually call someone called the duty manager infrastructure. This is basically the KLM IT help desk. You can call them at night, and then if a problem, if you have a problem with Flight 720, he will connect you to one of the Flight 720 developers, and hopefully they will solve your problem, no matter what day, no matter what time. So is this is all good now? No, it's actually not, because where are we running our predictions? This is a Python script. This is running somewhere on a Hadoop cluster node, because Flight 720, as you will see later on, is based on Hadoop as a technology. Distributed computing, you have a whole bunch of servers linked up together so we can store basically infinite amount of data and serve it as fast as possible. But we had no way to, nowhere else to run the prediction, so we have a Python script running on the Hadoop cluster node. We have some enterprise-y scheduling system, and we use it to schedule this Python script. Nobody knows how to use this scheduling system. You can only configure it using a client that runs on Windows laptops. Some of us actually have Macs, so that's a problem. And the predictions sometimes fail, and we get little to no feedback. And there's no standard deployment method because this Python script lives on this Hadoop cluster node. This also adds all kinds of extra problems because this Python script has a lot of dependencies. We use Anaconda. So now we have to open up the Hadoop cluster to the internet to get the packages in. Somebody forgets that they shouldn't actually use the root environment of Anaconda. So you get all these kinds of problems. This is not like optimal, but at least from the data side, we're now good because we have well-supported data in real time. So when we started out with mobs, we thought, okay, we can do even better, right? Because we got the input data, we got that right, but the predictions, it's still like a bit messy. So what is it actually that we want? We want real-time input data for our predictions. We kind of already ticked off that box, right? More recent data means better predictions. We want on-time predictions, so we get predictions at the right moments, these query moments that Alexander talked about, and with as little delay as possible. We want to have 100% coverage, so no missing predictions. We want to have monitoring and alerting. Basically, we don't want the business to call us that something is wrong. We want to know beforehand and fix it before the business even notices, right? And we want to have automatic retraining. So after a while, we collected some new data, and now we want to retrain the model to make it even better. So now I'm going to take a bit of a side tour to explain to you how does Flight 720 actually work? Because it sounds super nice, all this real-time data, but how do you do it? So the KLM has a lot of like backend systems, some of them mainframe, some of them somewhat more modern. These backend systems deal with bookings, passengers, baggage, flights, whatever you can think of, we have a backend system for it. A lot of these backend systems, luckily, they produce events. Whenever a mutation happens to some entity, let's say, for example, a passenger, the passenger, for example, checks in. This is a mutation to the passenger record in the backend system. It produces an event. These events are published to something which is called the Enterprise Event Broker. It's part of the Enterprise Service Bus. Does this sound super enterprise-y and corporate? Yes, it does. Do we, as a data engineering team want to deal with it directly? No, we'd rather not. So, because this is all SOAP-based, XML-based, we tend to think that we're a bit more modern than this, but what we are actually saying is we're too lazy to learn the old technologies. So what we're doing is we are asking the middleware team, yes, you have a middleware team, if you have an enterprise service bus, you have a middleware team. That's just the truth. So we ask them, please, can you convert this XML mess into JSON? So they say, sure, we can. And we know that, like, if you want to do real big data, you got to use Kafka, right? So we have these JSON messages published to a Kafka cluster. You can see it here to the left. Let's see if the pointer works. Yeah, it works. So here's Kafka. And then we get to the sexy part, and it's Spark streaming. Remember that I told you that we're building like the real-time view on a lot of these entities that happen in the flight domain, right? We want to know exactly everything there's to know about a certain flight lag at this right moment. So this is what the Spark streaming does. It receives all these updates from different sources, combines them into a view that is written to HBase. HBase is a scalable NoSQL database. That's not the only thing that happens. Sometimes there are systems that don't produce events. They only produce flat files. So we ingest them through some FTP flow, and we put them in HDFS. And through some process, they get put into HBase as well. And basically, then on top of HBase, we build a nice API. And this API serves this ground truth to the outside world, to any apps that want to use it, the consumers, but also to, for example, the predictions that need this as input data. The interesting thing is that because we're producing predictions and because we're combining events into, let's say, new intelligence, you might say that we also produce changes in the ground truth. So what we're doing is now we produce change notification events of ourselves. So where the backend systems produce events whenever a change happens, we do this as well. For example, whenever a prediction gets made in the backend, it gets stored in HBase, we produce an event, we publish it to Kafka, and it gets published to the enterprise event broker, the same thing here, and consumers can actually subscribe to it. So now they know that a new prediction has been made. So this is, in a nutshell, the data heart of the KLM operations. Next to this, which I don't have, which I didn't put on the slide, we also have, this is for like real-time operations, we also have a data lake, like a more traditional data lake, which is just a huge sandbox where we store all the incoming data, everything that comes from here, but even much more than that is in Flight 720, and we just store it as raw data for the data scientists to play with. They have like terabytes of the stuff, they can be happy, they don't bother the data engineers, it's super nice. So, remember that I told you about this Python script running on the Hadoop node? This was not really our intention, right? So, we have these nice pandas, data frames, and the model, and they like to live free, but don't mess up your Hadoop cluster. So, how did we solve it? We'll ship them in a container. Yes, KLM 2 totally drank the Docker Kool-Aid, and I kind of like it. Because now what we can do is we have this model, and it has this peculiar set of dependencies. For example, the what is the algorithm called again? LightGBM. I don't know if you remember that we had kind of a problem installing it on people's laptops. But in Docker, it's like a completely isolated environment. It's based on Linux, no Windows C bullshit. We can actually install all the dependencies that we want and package it neatly with the model, and it can run in isolation. This is super nice. So now we have a problem because we have a model, we want to make predictions with it, but we want to do it in a timely manner. Not only that, we want to make sure that we never ever miss any predictions. So we set out to split the code into a couple of different components, completely decoupled, that can operate independently of each other, and if one goes down, the other just keeps chugging along. So the first part in our chain is the scheduler. So the scheduler is a very simple Python script. It generates timestamps, and it generates timestamps based on these query moments. Not only for the MOBS model, for the PUX onboard model, it can do it for many models. So you can just configure it with a bunch of different models, and you can put in the timestamps, like the the moments relative to the departure of an airplane that are relevant for that particular model and that particular business case. It collects all of them and generates timestamps based on that. So what does it mean? You just create a message, a JSON message, which contains the name of the model, the particular timestamp, and what query moment it was. So it says, for example, this is 4 hours before departure, and then it gives you the actual timestamp. I will talk to you later about how this gets picked up and used. But now scheduling is decoupled from the prediction and from the database and from the input-output. So we queue these timestamps onto Kafka as JSON messages, and they get picked up by something we call the executor. So the executor allows us to predict in a robust way. So what we do is we listen to these timestamps from Kafka, and we read the features from HBase. Now we get to a very interesting property of HBase, because HBase is not your run-of-the-mill average database where you have rows and columns. It adds an extra dimension. It's called diversions. So now what HBase does is anytime we mutate a value in a column of a row, it will just create a new version of that column and that row and store it continuously. And we can look back in time to any version that existed before. This is super interesting, because even if we have like a 5 minute delay in creating our timestamp, but we want to make sure that for the prediction we use the exact features at that moment of that the timestamp actually should occur, we can look back into HBase and see what was the state of the world 5 minutes ago. So we're abusing that or using that to make the prediction, the right predictions with the right data at the right moment. In the end, the executor, when it will just call the model. So Alexander showed you that he created a super nice Python package for it, for which I thank you, because we didn't want to deal with Jupyter notebooks, so that was super nice. So the only thing that the executor had to do is use this Python package with the model as a dependency. We got a nice class with a predict and a train method on it, so we only need to put in the features into the predict method, and the results, we can write them back to HBase. And if you think back a bit about the picture of Flight 720, I told you there was a nice API on top of that. So now all the predictions get served by the same API, the Flight 720 API. So there's a nice property of decoupling the executor, the prediction part, from the scheduling part, because now if the database is down, which sometimes sadly happens, then the predictions, we cannot write back the predictions, but the timestamp will not get acknowledged from Kafka. We will tell Kafka, sorry, we were not able to properly process your message. And it will just get put back on the queue. And whenever the database is up again, it will gather all the remaining messages and make the predictions anyways, with the right features, because we use the versions from HBase. So now we have 100% coverage. It's super nice. So you might be asking, that sounds all nice and dandy, Dan, but this scheduler, this is like your single point of failure, right? If the scheduler goes down and doesn't generate any timestamps, where are we at, right? So the scheduler has a nice property as well, because when it starts up, it will look into Kafka and it will look, what's the latest message that I published? And then it will just calculate back all the missing timestamps since then and publish them anyways. So basically, if anything goes down, we can restart it and we can just keep creating the predictions. So now we come to the monitoring alerting part, because I actually, if I get called out of bed, I would rather just be it for the right reasons and not because the business discovered it before I did. So what we do, we have a bunch of metrics, like how long did it take to make the prediction? Did we make the prediction at all? How long was it since the timestamp was generated and we actually make the prediction? So are our predictions running late? We push these metrics to a technology called Prometheus. It's open source, it's very neat. It's a time series database to which you can basically publish any metrics you want, and you can visualize it in another technology called Grafana. So this Grafana, you can not only visualize it, you can actually use alerting on it. So you can say, if my prediction delay goes above 30 seconds, please send me an alert through email, Slack, pager, duty, whatever you want. So that's used mostly for monitoring the performance of the system, but there's of course also the performance of your model and the coverage part, because we promised that we would have 100%, and Joyce already spoiled the story for me by saying that we actually arrived at 100% coverage. But how do we know, right? Now, how do we know? Because we write these predictions to HBase, and we create a Hive table on top of this. Hive is basically SQL on Hadoop, so you can fire off SQL queries on your data in the Hadoop system. And we built a dashboard on top of it in Spotfire. And Spotfire is basically a visualization tool similar to Tableau, ClickView, and other visualization tools. So in this dashboard, we can show the business, the coverage, the model performance, etc. So if we put all of this together, and to also to go a bit more into detail on the pictures that both Joyce and Alexander showed you, we promised we would go into more detail, so here it is. So on the left side, you have this PAX forecast scheduler, and you have the PAX forecast executor. They both run inside Docker. And here we have the nice model package. And here we have Flight 720. So how does it interact? The PAX forecast scheduler publishes these query moment timestamps to Kafka. The executor picks them up again, makes a prediction. First it reads the features from HBase, then it writes the prediction back. Then it will generate a change notification. This change notification is published through the Enterprise Event Broker. It arrives at the mob system. Now the mob system knows, hey, a new prediction has been made, and it will query the API of Flight 720 to ask what the prediction was and what the contextual data was that led to this particular prediction. And now mobs can happily show it in the GUI to the catering services. So now they can order the meals. So this is basically, in a nutshell, how the whole mob system works. Industrialized and all. So to summarize a bit, I said that we need a real-time input data for our predictions. So we had Flight 720 do that, to provide the real-time data. We wanted on-time predictions. Having a dedicated scheduler helps us with that. We wanted to have 100% coverage. The decoupling between the scheduling and predicting helps with that as well. We want to have monitoring alerting, so we did that using a monitor using Prometheus, Hive, and Spotfire. But if you remember well, what I said earlier, I said we would have automatic retraining. I didn't mention that, right? So sadly, there wasn't a solution for this yet. So as a bonus, I will tell you a bit about how we proceed even from here, because this is all super nice, but we want to look at the future and have an even better system in place. So on the one hand, we failed to do some things, like the automatic retraining. We also miss monitoring the feature quality. What I mean by that is, let's say that one of the features is the number of bookings, and let's say that the model has been trained to know about 0 to 300 bookings, and suddenly we introduce a new aircraft type which can hold many more passengers, and then we see this feature get into the production data. Then we want to be basically alert on this, right? We want to say, hey, the feature has arrived at a point that I've never seen this before. How can this be? So we note that we can retrain, right? Maybe we can even automatically trigger a retraining. And we also don't monitor any evaluation metrics in real time. So it would be nice to be alerted if the mean absolute error goes beyond some acceptable point, right? But we also implemented a lot of good ideas. And so the question is, how can we generalize these lessons that we learned and implement them in such a way that all of our future models can benefit from this? Our data scientists are happy. And at the same time, fixing the mistakes or filling in the blanks that we didn't that we didn't cover yet. So what we created is Forge. Forge is a system that attempts to bring all of this together and gives the data scientist a generalized way of developing models, testing them, deploying them to production, monitoring them, automatically retraining them. So, yeah, it's a bit slow, the screen. So this is all that it facilitates. I already mentioned most of it. We automatically generate training sets, train the model. We expose the model through an API automatically. We don't want the data scientists to be bothered with this, right? I mean, creating an API on top of a model is a pretty standard thing. You can basically generalize over this. The same goes for deploying the model, generating the predictions at the right moment. I mentioned this, by the way, because this executor that I mentioned before, it's super nice for mobs, but it's also super tight into that particular model. So we want to generalize over that as well. We don't basically what we don't want is to recreate the same executor kind of setup for each new model, where let's say 80% of the code is the same. We want to have monitoring, evaluation, and alerting, and we want to retrain the model when new data is available, and we want to reiterate over that process when data and or the model changes. So basically, we want to say if you change the model code, you also want to retrain, right? So this is basically what we created. I think it's a bit, we'll probably not have enough time to go over this because it took us months to come up with a proper architecture here. But what we basically did here is generalize the whole concept of this executor scheduler setup that we had, and we added evaluation and retraining on top of it and hooked it into our build systems at KLM. So we use a proper continuous integration, continuous deployment pipeline. We use Bamboo for this. It's made by Atlassian. What it basically does, you create some code, you check it into Git, you push it, and then it will automatically build your Docker image, etc., and it might even automatically deploy it. And what we now do is we have this, we have our model, you push it, the Docker images get created, they get pushed to something called the Docker registry. It's basically a library of all the images that you know about. At the same time, this model is registered in some database where we store all kinds of metadata about the models, the version, but also some evaluation metrics. Then we kick off an automatic Spark job on the data lake where we generate a new set of training data. And the nice thing about this is that this whole the model that you create, you describe it in a configuration file. You basically mention what kind of features do we want in this model, what is my, let's say, reference column for my query moments. This might be the departure time, but it might also be some other timestamp. What query moments do I have? Is it 4 hours, 8 hours before? You can think of whatever things you want. And there's a version number in this configuration file, and this is used to store the metadata, but it's also used to automatically generate the right training data for your model. So we can kick off the training sequence. The training sequence runs on Kubernetes, on a Docker platform. It will basically pull in the model image that you already had. It will pull in the data from that was just generated by your Spark job. It will then train the model, then create a new Docker image of it and push it back here. Eventually, all of this is deployed to a running state. You see the deployed model here. The deployed model will tell Forge through some HTTP call, like an API call, "Hi, I'm a new model. This is my version. These are my features. These are my query moments. Please schedule me." And then we have a separate schedule component, which will do the scheduling part of the timestamp. It will generate messages whenever a prediction needs to be made. Like it will create a prediction request message, we call it. It will push it to Kafka. And then we have a separate component called the feature fetcher. It's nice alliteration. So what it does is it will pick up the right features from HBase, Flight 720, based on this prediction message. And then it will publish the enriched prediction request to Kafka again. This will get picked up by the model, which also listens to Kafka. It will make a prediction. We'll send the prediction to something called a persister, and this will store it in some kind of database. That's currently this HBase, but it can also be any other serving database. And we publish all kinds of performance metrics, and in the end, we can view it in dashboards in Prometheus and Grafana. So now, do we have a bunch of advantages? So we have strong decoupling of components, which we already, we had a first version of this in MOPS. We have robust type-safe code in Scala. Let me go back to show you a bit what I mean. So, of course, data scientists, I think a whole bunch of you probably code in Python, and there's, of course, nothing wrong with this. But for our production system, data engineers are much more confident when they can create their code in Scala because it's a type-safe language. They're used to working with it. So what we achieved with building this whole system is that we could actually decouple almost all of the, let's say, industrialization logic from the actual prediction logic. So this means that a data scientist can happily create the model in Python, but all of the other components are created in Scala. So the data engineers feel confident, the data scientists feel confident, and everybody is happy. So it's also robust in the face of failures. Any of these components can go down. You can start it up again, and it will pick up where it left off. It's scalable. We can actually put multiple feature fetchers or multiple persisters. We can put it in place and load balance all the messages between those components. It's simple and decoupled. It's performant, easy to monitor. And it's easy to get started with new models. In order to make that as easy as possible, we created a cookie cutter template. I don't know if you're familiar with cookie cutter. If you're not, you should really Google it. It's super nice. It allows you to create templates for code, for a repository basically, which you can just fill in some variables and it will automatically generate a skeleton for you. So we created a cookie cutter template for data scientists to start out with, and it will already contain all the code for creating the API, listening to Kafka messages, doing the pushing the metrics to Prometheus. The only thing they have to do is implement the model in it. So that's super nice. And basically, that is where we're at now. That's all. The Q&A?
Do you have questions?
Yeah, sure. Any questions?
Very nice, but still as a data scientist, I'm still a bit afraid of, you know, the whole structure that you created at the end, but still, you know, then some new type of library will come in. Of course, it can be then put in Docker, or you need some extra feature that is in there, and then, you know, one tweak here will still require a big change there, because otherwise it doesn't work. Aren't you afraid of that?
It depends on from whose perspective you're talking about. Because if you're talking from the perspective of data science, I'm not so afraid of it, because we ended up really nicely isolating the whole model part from the rest of the system. So you can actually use whatever libraries you want, even new ones, old ones. In general, I would say, yes, of course, we will discover new technologies, and they will probably be better than what we have now. And so that's why I would say, and this is maybe a strange thing to say in when I'm working for an organization like KLM, where they value like stability, I would say no. You should basically throw away parts of your system at least every year and create a new thing so you keep up to date and enjoy the best technology benefits, right? I don't know if that answers your question.
It does. I'm a bit afraid of new libraries that would have weird APIs, but you sort of assume they will all provide this.
Yeah. Exactly.
Thank you.
And did you start this this whole structure because of text to the mob project?
Yes.
Okay. And so it worked, I guess?
Sorry, okay.
My question is, have you tried it with another model so far?
No, we haven't tried it with another model, to be honest, because we have built, I think, like 50% of what I just showed you. It wasn't called the future for nothing. So we're confident that it will work for another model, and we're confident that it will bring us value because of the experiences that we had with mobs. But of course, there's no way to be sure. And while creating some components of this, we already encountered things that were different than we expected. So yeah, it's an ongoing process, I would say.
Yes, so I think you're beautifully guaranteeing eventual coverage with the Kafka H-based combination, but mm-hmm. You also see some weak points when you have, you know, latency requirements. Because I guess when
yeah, definitely.
Person says 100% coverage,
yeah.
You don't mean eventually.
Yeah, so the question is, we have 100% coverage, but do we also how do we deal with latency requirements? Because, for example, the KLM catering services will not really be happy if they receive the prediction 10 minutes late, because maybe they would have they are expected to press the order button already, right? So my answer to that would be there's currently no system in place or idea even in place to automatically like keep the latency low. But at least we now have very good monitoring to see if there's any latency and we can act upon it manually. So we chose all the components that we chose, like Kafka, Akka Streams, and these kind of technologies, because they are, well, while they don't guarantee low latency, they are, that's very probable that we will have low latency. And for the rest, we just need to monitor it.
Yeah, they're all streaming kind of things.
Yeah. So in our prediction system, we don't use Spark Streaming at all. It's in a Flight 720. On account of that, I would say Spark Streaming is quite a beast to tame to get it to perform the right way. But Flight 720 is quite a lot older than the whole MOB system already, and then what we're doing now with Forge. So we got quite some time to tune it, I would say. But Spark Streaming is indeed a bad one. I've personally not encountered a lot of latency with the other components like Akka Streams or Kafka, or even the combination of using Scala and Python doesn't give us a lot of problems. But to be honest, we're not pushing it to the max like companies like Twitter or Facebook are doing, right? I mean, KLM has a lot of data. I would say for a company within the Netherlands, we are one of the bigger companies when it comes to data. But yeah, it's not nearly web scale, or how you would call it. So I don't think we are seeing a lot of latency because we don't push the system that much. I think she was first, so is that okay?
Final question now.
Final? Mm-hmm. Can we do two so we can? Oh, we will cut off this nice late. So you first. Yeah. The question is, how do we manage to run the model with Spark in a container? Because how do we distribute it? So I think I was a bit unclear then, because our models are actually not created using Spark as a framework. Our models are just regular scikit-learn models, so they are not distributed in nature. This might also be a problem if you want to use a lot of data. So we're also experimenting with Spark MLlib, but it's not that mature yet. So there we don't have a problem. You can, however, run Spark on Kubernetes distributed if you want to inside Docker containers, but that's a different matter. We are not doing that currently.
But I think it was also a bit about the training set generator. Like, how does it know Docker, how does that deal with the Spark program running the training set?
Ah, like that. So the training set generator is not running in Docker at all. It's just by various different processes, like, for example, our build jobs in Bamboo and our CI/CD system, they can kick off the training set generator, but the training set generator itself is not running on Docker, it's running on the Hadoop cluster. Ooh, I have to look at the organization if that's possible. So that's a very good question. How do we manage our secrets inside our Docker containers to contact the Hadoop cluster? We have a separate service of that for KLM. It's called Squirrel, and you basically put encrypted passwords inside your Docker Compose file, and it will use some kind of API to get the real passwords out. So there's nothing like sensitive inside the code. Obviously, if you can break into the Docker container, you can still read the secrets and like the encrypted password and request the actual secrets anyways. But yeah, there's always some way to break security, right? Last question for you.
I want to ask about how often is this module being rerun every time? Because we saw before that this output that's being used to deliver to the catering, it can range from 2 weeks in advance to
Yeah.
So in between, we also see like the closer it becomes, closer to the departure time, the more accurate the output is. So So how often do, like, because then I assume the input for this each run would be different, like it's being updated.
Yeah, of course. That's why we have. So. Yeah, so you mean making the predictions, right? How often are the predictions made?
Yeah, do you do it every on weekly basis to update the whole inputs for the same flights, or?
No, actually we do it much more often, right? So so the way it's set up, we have these query moments. They're related to the, in the case of MOPS, to the scheduled departure time of a flight. And there's a bunch of like time windows in front of that on which we need to make a prediction. This is not happening on a weekly basis. What we actually, in the current MOP system, do is the scheduler will just take these query moments and generate them for every flight, potential flight, for every query moment. So you will have, we have 600 flights a day, something around that, more than 300 departing from Amsterdam. So it will make, for all these flights, it will generate predictions for these query moments. And it will do it in as real time as possible. So whenever we are 4 hours in advance of a particular flight, it will fetch all the features that are currently set on this flight, like this ground truth, which is real time. And then it will make a prediction based on that. If it will then make a prediction 2 hours in advance of the flight, the world has changed, and it will pick up the new features of this new changed world and make a new prediction.
So the difference is only comes from the adjustments in the input.
Yeah. Okay. I think that was it, right?
That was it.
Thank you all.
Thanks, Dan. That was it for the presentation part. I have one final plug for a sister meetup of ours. It's called Data Engineering NL.
Now we're talking.
Yeah. It's in 2 weeks from now on Wednesday, March 6th. It's a meetup by, we'll have John Goes, a functional programming wizard, who will explain us all the fun details about functional programming. However, at this point it's already fully booked.
Don't miss.
Obviously there's a catch. We're looking for a bigger venue, and we'll probably find it. So please stay tuned. Check out the meetup page. Put yourself on the wait list, and I'm sure that we'll find a bigger venue, and we'll have enough room for you guys. So that's that. Then I would like to ask the speakers to come forward. Now I realize I'm not using the mic, so sorry for the people online.
They're
not listening anymore. Can you please?
Oh,
yes,
you need to come forward. Then.
Yeah, obviously. Okay. Yeah. So I have some small gifts, some small thanks for you guys. I'll start off with Maarten.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you, Tom. It was a pleasure.
Some